Minister, do you think that EU foreign ministers can agree on completely stopping the visa facilitation agreement with Russia, and is that enough?
Well, honestly, I don't think that visa facilitation, cancelling the visa facilitation agreement is enough. It's a step to the right direction, but surely not the whole trip. That the countries in the region who have a border with Belarus or Russia are asking. I'm hoping for a fruitful debate. I think that this is one of those cases when actually a debate at the table has to happen, and I'm still hoping that it can bear fruit.
Well, what sort of compromise do you want to see? Because it has to be a compromise in the end, because we see Western European countries are not willing to follow suit from what Finland and the Baltic states want to do.
But there are two things that should be put on the table, and I believe that they will be put on the table. One thing is issuing new visas. And yes, you're very right that countries that have the border with Russia and Belarus, they already stopped issuing visas. So basically the people that we are seeing, hundreds of thousands of people we're seeing crossing the border to Lithuania, Latvia, Estonia, Poland and Finland, they have visas that are being issued by other member states. And a big group of those people are actually staying in the border countries. That means that somebody else is inviting them in, and they they continue to stay. And it is an issue. It's a safety issue, because the country is at war, and big numbers of people actually have been already at the front. They can come back and go to a spa in the town of Lithuania after spending some time at the front. So the notion of this is not particularly well taken by the by the public in the Baltic. And I think that this also has to be put on the table when we are discussing what kind of compromise has to be found. The second thing is, what do you do with all those visas that are already issued? And we're talking millions of visas that are valid as we speak. So where do those people go? How long can they can they travel? So talking about just stopping the issuing of new visas is also not the full trip. It's just one of the steps that could be taken in that direction.
But can you really touch visas that have already been issued? That surely is legally impossible.
It is legally possible. I mean, it is. They were issued by, according to Schengen rules, and Schengen countries can decide on how Schengen zone operates. So I'm not saying that it's easy. I'm not saying that it's very easily done or agreed upon, but surely it is doable and it is possible legally as well.
You saw the Franco-German public paper, you can say, or discussion paper, where they talk about actually asking the Baltic states, indirectly at least, not to follow through with these proposals, and also saying that we need to fight about the hearts and minds of the Russian people by offering people-to-people contacts. What do you say about this?
Well, I think that we've tried that, and we failed miserably. For 3 decades, Western European countries were not listening to the Baltics, and were trying to win hearts and minds. We're paying huge amounts of money to the for the gas, and inviting tourists and all whatnot. And out of this, we got 2008 war in Georgia, 2014 occupation of Crimea, and now we have a full-scale war in Ukraine. So that's how many hearts and minds we've won in Russia. It's time to wake up.
But then the other argument is always this thing about collective responsibility. Is there such a thing? Can we really punish all Russians?
It's not about punishment. It's basically asking ourselves a question. Is a right to spend some leisurely time in European Union is a human right? And I don't think so. It's a privilege. And countries usually have to earn this type of privilege. So that's that's one thing. But then again, the big part of the debate is not just about sending a message to a population or something like that. It's about security. It's simply it's in my country, Russia, is considered by the parliament a country that supports terrorism. So clearly we have an issues of Russians traveling to or through my country and our neighbors' countries, and it's an issue that has to be taken very seriously.
Turning to Belarus, the fence, the Lithuanian fence on the Lithuanian-Belarusian border is now complete. What will that mean for your security when it comes to Belarus?
Well, again, for 3 decades, you know, we've even though we felt that issues might arise, and we've been informing the others. You know, there was some homework that we ourselves have not done. So I'm happy that this part of the homework is complete, or almost complete. The border is not just defense; it's also, you know, a technological border. That means that there are cameras, there are other instruments that help us guard the border. So we might know, we might be better prepared in case of a hybrid attack. And actually, you know, what is already being proven, that the numbers of illegal migrants that are being sent to the Lithuanian border are being growing steadily.
Do you think that the completion of this fence will take down the numbers again?
It discourages the regime to send people, because a year ago it was extremely easy. You know, just point to the forest, you tell the people to find some trees and, you know, and follow the trees, and they will, you know, appear in Lithuania or Poland or Latvia. Now it's not that easy, unfortunately. I mean, but it's this border is guarded. The European border is guarded.
See it in any way that this can further prevent you from having any meaningful relationship with Minsk?
Well, that's a very good question, and I think it's a bit more strategic than that. You know, we have to have a difficult debate: what is relationship with Minsk, what kind of relationship we want with Minsk, and what kind of future for itself Minsk would want. So I think that without answering these questions, it's impossible to answer the question that you're raising. What is the future, the political future of Belarus? Is it still an independent country? How much independence does it have? I would say that probably, you know, if there were this kind of term, we would call it a partially occupied country.